Yeah, it feels a little bit strange to be at the end of a 4.5 year journey that had lots of ups and downs. It wasn't always easy, but it was a tremendous experience for me, for sure, as a young scientist, but I think also for everyone involved in this project. I had a great team and I'm super happy to have worked with every single one of them, the students, the PhD students, the master's students, but also the people that we've met along the journey, the collaborators that we worked with and the communities that welcomed us. Very little is known about the reality of living in the South Pacific, a region that is really vastly affected by climate change, is at the same time very fragile, but also very strong and resilient. And I think this complex story needs to be told more. And I hope that our project and the outcomes help to put the region and the changes that are going on there in the life of the people there more on the map and on the consciousness of people. And I'm really thankful also now that we have the opportunity to go back once again and discuss with the communities that we've worked in, but also with stakeholders and policymakers in the region to make sure that the results are in the right hands to make a difference. And I'm looking forward to going back. The overarching goals of the RapiCore project are within the frame in which it is placed, this BMBF program, Research for Sustainability. So the context is sustainability research and global environmental change. And in RapiCore, in particular, we're looking at the South Pacific region, which is faced by a drastic environmental change at the moment, so global climate change that is affecting the reefs in the area, but also societal changes that are sweeping through the region, such as integration into a market economy, cultural changes at the local level, and that is kind of the background of the program. We wanted to see how these environmental and societal changes are affecting the reef, coral reef resources in the area, coral reef ecosystems, and the ecological processes within these ecosystems, but also the social systems, the communities, the coastal communities that are depending on these coral reef systems and the interactions between these two. So we had a postdoc working on ecology, and we had 3 PhD students, some of them working on social science aspects and one on ecology. We also had master's students that we involved in the project. And besides this core team of scientists, we had local and international partners that helped us in carrying out this program. So we had in-country partners from NGOs, from universities and from government institutions, but we also had external academic partners who were either strong in the particular scientific disciplines that we are including in this project and or that had been working in this part of the world for a very long time and thus were really experienced and knew some of the things that we wanted to study and some of the challenges that we're facing here. So that really helped us to build a strong project and implement it in a very locally grounded way, if you want.
Coral reef ecosystems are currently under a huge amount of stress from both local activities, increasing rates of fishing, increasing local pollution, for example, and also from climate change, where storms are increasing in intensity and there's increasingly elevated sea surface temperatures. I'm a coral reef ecologist, and my role within the Replicor project was to look at how human activities influence their adjacent coral reefs in terms of their state, but also in terms of their resilience. So resilience means the reef's ability to resist and to recover from disturbances, for example, those associated with climate change. So I looked at both how humans negatively influence reefs through overfishing of key species and through, for example, sewage input. But I also looked at how humans have the potential to positively influence reef systems through local management. And I approached my work from a variety of different angles, both from small-scale underwater surveys and also through using pre-collected data that spanned the Pacific region, which allowed me to ask a variety of different questions and to approach them from a variety of different scales. One of the main findings of my work was that benthic cyanobacteria mats are becoming more of a problem in the Pacific. So not many people are talking about these mats at the moment, but they are becoming increasingly reported from around the world. So these are basically a mat of bacteria that grow over reefs. They can grow very quickly over different organisms, and they have a multitude of different effects on the system through stopping coral babies from settling, through directly killing mature corals. And their growth is increasing due to a variety of different stresses, such as sewage input, land runoff, also from overexploitation or removal of some key species in the ecosystem, such as sea cucumbers. And these mats, as well as having negative effects on reef ecosystems, can potentially harm or be harmful for human health. Some recent studies have shown that if people ingest fish that have fed on these mats, then they can exhibit a sickness that's quite similar to ciguatera. An analysis of a large pre-collected data set across the Pacific showed us also that reefs that are exposed to higher densities of human populations start to react very unpredictably to climate change-related stresses. Whilst we can predict relatively well how reefs that are less impacted by humans are going to respond to climate change, as human populations and their associated activities increase, this predictability decreases. So it becomes very challenging for us to predict how reefs close to humans are going to look in 10, 20, 30 years. Another pertinent finding of my work is that we can really improve the usefulness of the information being conveyed by reef surveys by incorporating some additional metrics into our protocols. Instead of just understanding the state of your ecosystem, how is it looking right now, you can start to understand, is your ecosystem recovering or is it deteriorating, by measuring metrics such as algal turf height. So algal turf, they're these filamentous algae that basically cover every non-living substrate on a reef. Just by understanding how much of it is there doesn't give us so much information. But by understanding the height of the algal turf canopy, you can start to interpret how successful coral recruitment is going to be. So how many baby corals are going to be able to settle and grow. Longer turfs inhibit this. You can also start to understand how competitive these turfs are against neighboring corals. So the longer the turf height, the more competitive it is, and the more mortality of tissue in the neighboring corals it will cause. And turf height, it reflects environmental conditions and also grazing by herbivorous fish. So this very simple metric can provide very useful information for researchers and for managers. While communities on small tropical islands have a very small impact on climate change and thus can't do much about climate change themselves, there's still things that they can do locally that can improve the ability of the reefs to survive into the future. Managing certain species, restricting fishing at certain times of the year, reducing sewage input through installing composting toilets, reducing harvesting of species such as sea cucumbers. These kind of steps can make a significant difference in the health of reefs and their ability to be resilient in the face of ongoing climate change.
within the RepiCorp project, I was mainly responsible for the governance part, which means I looked at the local level at community-based marine resource management approaches, looking at how communities locally manage their resources, what kind of setups they have developed, what are the processes to reaching these setups and the rules that have been established. But I also looked at how these local management approaches interlink and interconnect to the national level marine governance framework. So this is mainly fisheries and environmental legislation that affects coastal fisheries. Basically, I have two local case study sites, one in Solomon Islands here in Western Province in Roviana Lagoon, and one in Fiji on the island of Ovalau. And I spend a couple of weeks in both sites, living with the local communities and doing a lot of interviews with villagers, that is, with fishermen, fisherwomen, with young people, people who are involved in the local management, which is often the chiefs or members of the Council of Elders. And I also conducted focus groups, so sort of small workshop type of discussions around different topics regarding the local marine management to get their local perspective and to see also how things have changed over time and what are currently the main factors or drivers of local marine management. I think one of the main points I would like to highlight is about the role of women. So women in most of the coastal communities have really a crucial role to play when it comes to contributing to household food security and also income. They really actively participate in fishing activities, but they are much less involved in the management of local marine resources. So there's sort of a discrepancy. And one of my studies actually showed that involving women would make local management even stronger, because women, due to the fact that they have an active role in the fishery, also have a potential ecological role to play. So that means if women do not accept local management rules, they can also contribute to over-harvesting. So oftentimes women have different fishing activities. They fish in different areas than male fishermen. They collect invertebrates, whereas men might rather do spear fishing. So they have different fishing gear and different fishing areas. And local marine management plans should definitely also consider these female fishing activities. The second point I would like to highlight is the Pacific region, and then in the Solomon Islands and Fiji, it's really, in terms of the governance, it's really a unique situation, because you have sort of a dual governance system. You have these really strong customary governance systems based on customary fishing rights. Local communities really have a lot of autonomy and say on how they manage their resources locally, while at the same time you have the national level with fisheries legislation, environmental legislation that also affects coastal and marine areas. So this is basically a challenge to get these two systems to work together and to be mutually supportive. But if it works well, it can really be also an opportunity, because it's a great strength that local communities have a long tradition and a lot of knowledge on how to locally manage resources.
My name is Aquila Dagadaka. I am from Fiji. I'm a social scientist in this project. My interest is on looking at how climate change and changes in different resources affects the livelihoods of people, and how will this in turn affect their income sources within communities. And the first objective of my study was to see what were the main drivers of reef resource use within these coastal communities. The next one was characterizing different communities and different households, looking at how vulnerable were they or are they to changes in reef resources and also climate change. The third question that I tried to answer was to look at adaptation and adaptive measures and strengths that these communities have that would enable them to mitigate and fight climate change and also changes in reef resources, which they rely upon mainly as a source of livelihood, for income and for food. I believe that this study had evidence, concrete evidence, that the importance of people to understand what is happening in the oceans, the dynamics of coral reefs, and link it to people that rely on them, and then having to understand how these resources are governed make this project super special. And I would like to thank Dr. Sebastian Fersey mainly for bringing this thought out and having this project being tested in the region here in the Pacific, which I would commend him for that.
I think when you're studying tropical coastal systems, it's not possible to do so by separating ecology and social science. You have to understand and study both if you want to make meaningful science and if you want to really understand the dynamics of these systems. You could separate and focus on individual parts, but you're not really going to see the big picture. There are very strong interactions between humans and the ecosystems that they depend on for their livelihoods in the tropics and tropical coasts. So these are by nature integrated, strongly linked, coupled social ecological systems, and that necessitates in studying them that you're looking at both the social side and the ecological side. Some of the key outcomes for me of this project is one that we could show really clearly in many examples, in several examples, the impact that people are having on coral reef ecosystems. And another key outcome for me is to show what individual species that are economically important to people, important for livelihood and food security, what kind of ecological role they have. So we have key species identified, and this is really relevant for management and can make a real difference, not just the scientific outcome. I hope that the findings that we produce with this project are not just good scientific outcomes and findings, we have our papers and so on, but also that the findings are useful for improved management and for a more sustainable use of marine resources and ultimately for a better life of the people in the places where we worked.